Hi there, and welcome to How Music Expresses. I'm Alexey Nikolsky, composer and musicologist with a doctorate degree from the Moscow Tchaikovsky Conservatory. In this video, I'm going to talk about the most common thing that everyone who has ever taken music lessons knows about and has drilled as an essential part of their training. Yes, I'm talking about the good old scale. Here, I'm going to explain what a music scale is and why it is one of the essentials of basic music theory. Many musicians, or non-musicians, think that scales are things to be drilled for the purpose of gaining technical fluency, and that scales are one of the basics of music grammar, like chords or intervals. But they assume this axiomatically, without any understanding of where scales come from and what makes them so important. Almost all college textbooks and educational materials online present scales in this dogmatic way. As a result, students of music rush to learn the major and minor scales and drill playing or singing them without giving it any thought. In this video, I will fill this gap and explain what a scale actually is, how it is derived, and how it can help a performer or a composer in making music. Okay, let's first define a scale. Music scale is a set of pitch classes derived from a piece of music and arranged in an ascending or descending order based on the principal tone in that music work. The notion of a pitch class is fundamental for understanding scales. Pitch class is a specific frequency which, together with its binary multiples, is viewed as a single entity. Whenever the frequency of a musical tone is doubled, our ear perceives it as the same pitch, reproduced an octave higher. This is reflected in the nomenclature of pitches. For instance, all A's belong to the same class, and all G's belong to a different class, and so on. This is fairly obvious not only from looking at the score, but through hearing music, pretty much for anyone with normal hearing. Multiple pitches of the same class sound as one. Tones an octave apart blend in together so perfectly that many listeners have difficulties hearing each individual tone. In contrast, pitches that belong to different classes do not blend together and are heard distinctly, even if they form consonant relations with one another and therefore fuse relatively well. Disregarding all the octave dubs within a given piece of music reduces the cognitive overload in analyzing music. Instead of dealing with great multitude of notes, musicians end up having just a few basic pitch classes to consider when learning or conceiving a music piece. Such a reduction reveals the underlying foundation of a music composition, so that one can easily see how two pieces of music, or two sections in the same composition, compare in their tonal organization. Just as the kind of brick selected for building a house affects the look of the house, the musical tones selected for a piece of music determine the expression of that music. For example, music that uses only pitch classes of the major scale, as a rule, sounds happy. Some other piece of music that shares the same scale also usually shares a similar expression. Take, for instance, the first Noel. it very much resembles the character of Joy to the World. In contrast, music based on an entirely different scale, as a rule, carries an entirely different expression. For instance, if the music uses only the pitch classes of the octatonic scale, it sounds mysterious and strange. And other pieces of music that use the octatonic scale also sounds mysterious and strange. Knowing the scales and their corresponding expressions is useful not only for composing music, but also for performing an already existing music. Thus, it would be unsuitable to sing or play a melody written in a major key with a sad expression, unless it occurs in a sad scene of a stage work and presents a special effect. Here, we approach a very important point. In order for music to effectively communicate, every composer and performer has to know the scales that are most commonly used in a given style and genre for conventional expressions. The word convention implies that there is a naturally evolved agreement between the majority of listeners, performers, and composers as to which particular musical elements are suitable or unsuitable for certain expressions. Composers choose a suitable scale before they actually set out to compose a piece of music. They use the tones of that scale to generate melodies and harmonies. Performers have to do the reverse, to examine the music they want to perform and extract those scales that were used to make this music. But there are a few caveats here. In many cases, extraction of a scale from music is straightforward. The key signature points to the scale in which a musical composition is written, but it doesn't specify the tonic, because each key signature indicates two possible keys of relative major and minor. You still have to analyze the music in order to figure out which of the two relative keys is actually engaged in a piece. And key signatures do not always reflect changes in tonal organization. Thus, the so-called Picardy cadence is quite common, where the music in a minor key suddenly ends in parallel major, without a change in key signatures. Some compositions take the Picardy principles a step further and keep alternating between the relative and parallel keys. Composers try to be original, or to look fancy, like Satie in his Gymnopedia No. 1. Thank you. He reverses the Picardy cadence by ending music in the major key with its parallel minor, which sounds quite weird. Furthermore, starting from the early 20th century, many composers stopped using key signatures altogether. And yet another obstacle is that in ensemble music, different instruments might use different keys while playing together. For instance, what is C major for flute would be D major for clarinet and G major for horn. For these reasons, I wouldn't recommend relying on key signatures alone. Just play the music and see which pitch classes it uses most often, and which of them feels the most stable, that is, which of the pitch classes provides a sense of finality for the music, or a music segment in question. Quite often, this is pretty obvious. Let's take Mason's Joy to the World. If we write all the notes out, it will be easy to arrange them according to their pitch. There are 17 pitches that engage 7 pitch classes. Scales like this are called heptatonic, from the Greek hepta, which means 7. Western classical music before the 20th century was based primarily on heptatonic scales. This arrangement of Joy to the World uses the B-flat major scale. The B-flat sounds the most stable of its pitch classes. Pretty straightforward. But in real life, things are not always that simple. Let's take the fantasy Joy to the World for organ by the English composer Edwin Lemaire. It uses a single instance of F sharp that immediately gets cancelled into F natural. Such a momentary change does not introduce an additional pitch class. It forms what is called a chromatic alteration. Here, the fifth degree of B flat major, F, is temporarily sharpened to get closer to the G that follows it in the melodic figuration. As you see, extracting a scale from music requires interpretation and careful deliberation as to which of its pitches constitute permanent pitch classes and which their temporary alterations. Alterations can occur not only in heptatonic major and minor. Octatonic music can also incorporate alterations, such as Prelude No. 3, Opus 74 by Scriabin. It uses the same octatonic scale that I demonstrated earlier in Rimsky-Korsakov. But in Scriabin's melody, a passing tone is inserted between A and G to smoothen the descending motion. In essence, this is similar to the alteration of F sharp in our previous example. Yet another challenge is to correctly identify the first degree in a scale. Different scales might share the same set of pitch classes and differ only in what is considered the first degree. In classic Western music theory, this first degree is called the tonic. For instance, the relative minor and major scales share the same pitch class set, but each have a different first degree. Tonic should be identified empirically, by ear, by figuring out which of the pitch classes sounds the most stable, that is, which tone can terminate a music work or a musical phrase so that the listener experiences a sense of completion. Many sources on music theory say that all you have to do in order to find the tonic is to look at the bass note in the last chord that terminates a music composition. But this tip doesn't really work in quite a number of situations. When representing a vague or an elusive image, composers deliberately end the music indecisively, not on tonic. Listen to this Lieder by Schumann. It ends as though with a question mark to illustrate the lyrics where the protagonist confesses his love for his beloved and eagerly awaits her response. Composers sometimes disrupt the ending in order to reflect the program of the music, such as the second Mephisto waltz by Liszt. It begins and ends with an unresolved triton, a musical interval believed by romantic composers to represent the devil in music. Non-tonic endings are not limited to Western classical music. In many styles of Mediterranean and Central Asian music, a piece ends on a pitch class that sounds like the fifth degree, asking for a resolution to the tonic, but not receiving it. Music theorists call this a dominant key, referring to the dominant function of harmony. This function is supposed to lead to the resolution into tonic. An example of the dominant key is the Andalusian dance from Bizet's Carmen. This famous composition starts and ends with the A major chord, where the composer placed the B flat as the key signature, implying D minor. However, the A major sounds quite stable, albeit not as stable as D. Some compositions are built so that they periodically oscillate between two tonics, like a seesaw. Music theorists call this double tonic. In this music by Glinka, the alternation between relative major and minor occurs so regularly that it produces its own metric pulse. All such tricky cases require careful and deliberate evaluation of the entirety of the music score by ear. The sense of finality that spots the tonic is generated by the combination of factors. 1. First of all, the most stable degree is used more frequently than the unstable degrees. 2. It usually receives a longer duration and louder dynamics. And 3. It is placed in more noticeable spots, such as the endings or beginnings of a musical phrase, and placement on a stronger metric time, such as the downbeat. The issue of tonicity makes the task of extracting scales harder, requiring deeper assessment of pitch classes. Finally, a few words about why a musician benefits from learning scales. The primary benefit is mental, to get a gestalt sense and feel for the music. For the performer, it is the music to perform, and for the composer, it is the material for making melodies and harmonies. While practicing a scale, the performer experiences an overall impression of how its pitch classes are joined together, which of them require stressing and which don't, so that they flow to the stress tone. The second reason is psychoacoustic. It has to do with integration of sounds. Just as a scale represents the backbone that holds together the entire composition, playing a scale across a number of octaves secures the smoothness in transitioning from one like upper to the other like lower register, and maintains the timbral uniformity across the entire range of pitches in a music piece. Say, if a piece engages three octaves, drilling a three-octave scale would unify all its pitches. Drilling a scale here acts like getting used to and envisage a snapshot of the entire range of pitch classes. The third reason is physiological and technical, to secure the fluidity in carrying the principal melody, as well as the figurations and the accompaniment. Playing a scale in a fast tempo requires timely preparation for changing the position of the hand every 3-4 notes. Achieving such preparation guarantees that any hand shifts from one position to another while playing a melodic phrase or an accompanying figuration will not induce any unwanted artifacts, such as limping or tripping over. For singers, drilling scales also secures smoothness in critical areas, where the voices naturally break into different registers. Moreover, scales optimize the singer's intonation by standardizing the exact tuning for each of the pitches used in a given composition. Singers memorize such tunings psychophysiologically as to which specific place in the vocal cords to contract. This way, well-trained singers developed a perfect pitch execution. They can hit a perfectly tuned C or D from memory without the support of any musical instrument. Instrumentalists can also benefit from singing scales, since singing is the easiest way to set the target phrasing for an instrumental scale, to join all the notes with a good legato while clearly articulating each note, and to mark a gradual crescendo at the beginning and diminuendo at the end of the scale. Moreover, instrumentalists learn from the sensation in their vocal cords too, which amount of tension is optimal for a given stress tone in a melody. This is important for figuring out a proper rubato and dynamic shaping that involves crescendo, diminuendo, accents, and sudden dropouts. For instance, if a descending C major melodic phrase starts on B, this B has to be marked with slight elongation and accent, because the seventh degree in a scale is the most unstable and eager to resolve upwards. So moving it down violates this norm and therefore requires an extra effort that thereafter has to comfortably subside. To sum things up, a musical scale is the assortment of pitch classes selected to construct music. Composers and improvisers make such selections prior to conceiving their music. And performers have to figure out all the pitch classes in the compositions that they're going to perform when learning it. This involves identifying all the alterations and modulations if the composition consists of a few sections, each with its own tonic. In this case, a performer will have to practice a suitable scale for each of the sections to obtain the desired fluidity and integrity. Both composers and performers benefit from reducing music to a specific scale, because each type of scale is characterized by its own expression. The set of pitch classes embedded in a scale determines its expression. Having a clear understanding of scale topology and mastery of the fluent performance greatly simplifies the work of the performer, as well as the composer. If you are interested to know how different scales can be simultaneously combined, and how this affects the expression, I'll cover this in a separate video. I hope that you now have a better understanding and appreciation for the significance and the contribution of scales to music. Please write any comments or questions, and I'll be happy to address them. If you have found this video interesting, go ahead and press the like button, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel. Bye-bye.